Good morning. Merry Christmas Eve. You know, it's always fun when Christmas Eve or Christmas falls on the Sunday, because either you have a lot of people, because everybody's traveled to Tuscola, or you have not so many because they've traveled away. So you never know what you're going to get on service days like this. But in the Bible, it says where two or more are gathered in his name, he's there in the midst. We've got that. Imagine what happened in the upper room with just another handful of people. So just because the seats may look a little sparse, that doesn't mean that God is not here. So let's stand. We're going to do some traditional Christmas songs today. And I ask that you just worship him, especially when we get to... We're going to sing Agnus Dei, the Michael W. Smith, Alleluia. Imagine when we sing that one later on. When you are in the throne room of God in heaven, and you're bowing before him and you're singing to him with the angels around you. You're singing with the host of angels. You're singing with those that have gone before. Imagine what that will be like. I mean, I'm sure all of you have had an opportunity to worship in a huge auditorium with thousands of people. If you haven't, you need to figure that out. It's amazing. I know we're getting ready to do that this week with the youth. We're going to go this week, and there will be 5,000 or more young people worshiping. It is the most exciting thing. It's worth no sleep. It's worth the yelling car rides. It's worth it all to see them truly worship. As I get older, the music seems louder, but that's okay. It is worth it. And even if it's a genre of music that may not be your cup of tea, when you hear these speakers, these musicians speak about what they're doing, and they speak to these youth, and they are reaching them at their level, it is so amazing to where you're like, I can get into this even if it's not my style. Because it's truly worshiping God. So it doesn't matter what style of music it is. If your heart is there and you are truly worshiping God, you should be able to worship in any service, anywhere. It depends on if your heart is right. I've learned you can't judge a book by its cover. Because sometimes we say, how could you ever find any worship in that? Or that's just so boring. How could you find any worship in that? The worship isn't about the style of song, it's about your heart. So as the drummer boy brings his gift of drumming, let's bring our gifts to him today by offering him our worship. Happy birthday, Jesus. We love you and we are so grateful that you came to this earth to our level. Just so that you would live amongst us and bring salvation to all of your people. I pray today that wherever people are choosing to worship, whether it be at home, watching YouTube channels or Facebook Live messages, Lord, that they will be able to truly take time to worship you. And Lord, I pray for those that have not made the choice and the decision to choose you as their Lord and Savior, that Lord, someone will minister to them today and they will be able to say, this day, I choose you. This day, I will make room for you in my life. We thank you for all this. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let's make sure I don't have transpose on. That's what I was afraid of.
Heaven and nature see, and heaven and nature see, and heaven and nature see. the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy. No more let sins and sorrows grow, nor thorns infest the ground. He comes to make his blessings flow, far as the curse is found, far as the curse is found. Far as the curse is found, he rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love. Receive a king. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and heaven and nature sing.
Let us adore him today. Christ Jesus, the King.
Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to bed.
Glory.
God Almighty reigns. Alleluia.
Worthy is the Lamb, you are holy.
just going to wait upon the Lord. If you're hurting and you feel like the world is crashing in on you, that there is nothing Christmas about this year, just look up to heaven. He is here for you. He will help you through. If your heart is broken into a million little pieces, He will mend it. Just look up to heaven. Just look up to the heavens. He will heal your heart. He will make you free. We come against the spirit of depression in this place. We come against all the things that are bringing you down. For Jesus Christ has risen, and He has come, and He's coming again. There is hope. There is hope in Him. Father God, I just pray that during this stressful day and the next couple of days, that You will just bring peace into the homes. And Lord, I pray for every mom and dad right now that are feeling less than enough, that Lord, You will just wrap Your arms around them, and they will feel Your mighty touch, and they will feel Your loving arms wrapped around them, that they will see that You are there for them. And Lord, I pray for every young person in this place that is maybe hurting this season, and they are just trying to grasp for anything to bring them joy. Lord, I pray that they will look to You for that joy, not to any person and not to anything, but to You. Let that be our prayer for all of us. I pray for restoration in the families. In the mighty name of Jesus, there's power in His name. 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 Just speak the name of Jesus. 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 I just keep hearing, whatever your situation is, just speak Jesus. 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 Jesus.
Amen. You may be seated. Thank you for being here today on Christmas Eve Sunday. This is a special day, and I hope that as you've made Jesus a priority today, because I think every one of us could have found something else to be doing this morning, but yet you've chosen to make the Lord your priority. And God's going to bless that. I just know that He will. And plus, you will know what day of the week it is, because if you don't come to church on Sunday, you're always like, is this Tuesday? Is this Monday? You know, that's the way I am. So I'm glad you're here. Thank you for worshiping with us. We have some guests. It's nice for Marianne and I today. We've got Daniel and Nikki and Michael here with us, and we've been enjoying them this week. If you can imagine this scenario in the elder household, late last night, because I don't stay up past 10 o'clock on Saturday night, but made an exception. Imagine Marianne wearing virtual reality goggles and virtual reality things on her hands, and she is the giant tree throwing balls at the four of us who are squirrels trying to steal the acorns. And I mean, Marianne was just over there chuckling. I mean, it was like, honey, we got to go to bed. We got to quit. And she's like, nah, and she'd keep going and throwing the balls, and she's just having a great time. And so we had a lot of fun with that last night. So, you know, it's good to laugh, good to have the holidays where we can be together. And so thank you for making your church family a priority, because that's what we are. We are a family that gets together every week, all year long. And if you don't have a church family out there in Facebook, maybe you're listening today and you'd like to have a church family, well, you could see there's plenty of room for you. We would love to have you come and join us. So before we receive our offering, just a couple of things to mention. All these poinsettias have served bravely, but they are in need of some love. So if you'd like to take one home today, please do that. And we'd like to see all these poinsettias have a new home after service today. Also, just want to mention Tom and Loretta. God bless you. Have fun in Texas. We're going to miss these guys. Make sure you give Tom and Loretta a good hug and send them on their way with blessings. And the youth, Tara, how many people do you have going this week? Okay, so 12 people are going down to Branson to a winter conference that is, I think, a guaranteed opportunity for everybody to get pumped up. So you'll be gone, what, Wednesday? Okay. All right, so Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Okay, good luck with that. Yes, we will pray that you guys, all of you, and any brave souls that would like to next Sunday, tell us what you experienced at the conference. We would love to hear that. So anyway, that's something to pray about, because, you know, we want to see our young people get excited about Jesus and filled with every good thing that God has for them. So this conference is going to be a great thing. So thank you to those that have supported financially, and we'll be praying. That is very appreciated. All right, we're going to receive our offering this morning, and then at the end of the offering, John back there in the video booth is going to run a little Christmas video. So let's pray. And the way we do offering here is just, if you've not already brought your offering up, and if you have a gift today, just bring it up as Tara and Elena bless us in song. Let's pray. Father God, thank you again for your provision in 2023. God, we put our confidence in you. God, we see prices and we see the challenges, but yet we also see Jesus, that you've said in your word that if we will just seek you first and your kingdom, that all these things, all these material things that we need for life, that Jesus, you will take care of them. And we thank you for making a way for us. Thank you, God. I just speak financial blessing over this congregation, that as they close out this year, that God, that they would just find themselves in a good place, because God, you have blessed them. So I thank you, God, for the faithfulness and the giving of this congregation in 23. And I pray, God, that they would just richly enjoy every need supplied. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Take me back to 8 years old, the little church on a dead-end road, with a candle flicker in one hand and Dad's hand in the other. Take me back to silent night, my heart was full and the world was right, 'cause right now the world looks nothing like those innocent Decembers. These days, peace on earth is hard to find, and I need you to remind me one more time. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope Christmas. You're still the hope of my heart. Watch the snowflakes falling down like a blanket on this town. For a moment we can hardly see the pain this year has brought us. May the sick find healing's touch. May hatred's fight be won with love. May every heart make room for you, the one who came to save us. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the hope of my heart. I bowed my head to pray tonight. Felt a little one by my side. They slipped their tiny hand in mine, and we both talked to you. Took me back to 8 years old, my daddy's hand in a story told about heaven's love and a manger low and a promise that's still true. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. And you're still the hope of my heart. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. And you're still the hope of my heart.
Well, amen. I like that little video, and it is a great introduction to the message this morning. Before I get going, though, I will dismiss our young people to their Sunday school classes and appreciate our teachers. The video wants to play again. Well, the title of my message today is The Great Exchange, and I'm not talking about the exchange that's going to happen at the Walmart service counter on Tuesday. You know, it's like save the receipts, right? Because we may want to exchange this or that for the different size, for a different color, or whatever that is. So, the Great Exchange is not about Christmas presents, but it is about what I wholeheartedly believe is the greatest, the most beneficial exchange that has ever taken place. And I want you, if you have your Bible, or we're going to read it off the screen here, we're going to read 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 20 and 21. Now, obviously, this is not a traditional Christmas message, but this gets really to the heart of what Christmas is all about. So if you've ever wondered, and there's folks here today that I don't know or don't know very well, and I just want to say that if you have kind of wondered, why do Christians get so excited about Jesus at Christmas time? Well, I hope by the end of this message you'll understand that. So 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verses 20 and 21. Now, this is the words of the Apostle Paul, one of the great men of God in his generation, responsible for writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit many of our books in our New Testament. And Paul was a passionate evangelist. And here's what he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20. He says, "We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. For God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." I believe that this passage sums up in pretty short order the whole reason for Christmas. Now, if you're a regular here at Eagle Mountain, you've heard me quote and read and talk about this passage because it is one of my favorites that tells us what God has actually done for us and how he has transformed our lives. So I want to unpack this here briefly. I know that everybody has things going on, but, you know, if we miss the heart of the message of Christmas, we've missed the most important thing. So what is Paul telling us here? You know, he doesn't talk about wise men. He doesn't talk about shepherds. He doesn't talk about baby Jesus. But he talks about the whole reason why Jesus came to this earth, why Jesus chose to come and do a great thing some 2,000 years ago. You know, it was prophesied, it was told to both Joseph and to Mary in angel visits that there was going to be a son that was to be born. And not only was there a son, but the son had a very specific name, and that name was Jesus. Both of them were told his name will be Jesus. You think, well, why Jesus? Well, Jesus is the Greek version of the Hebrew name Joshua. And the name Joshua means the Lord saves. And then the angel explained it to Joseph. He said, for his name will be Jesus because, why? He will save his people from their sins. That was the whole purpose of Jesus coming, was to be a savior. You know, if you were a Jew in Jesus' day, when you would think savior, you would have thought a political or a military leader who would have come and kicked the Romans out and restored Israel to its rightful place sense of freedom and power, but that was not the freedom that Jesus came to bring. Jesus came to bring us a personal freedom, a freedom that results in us being forgiven of our sins and having a restoration to our Father God in heaven. Jesus came so that we might have life. You know, there's a lot of gifts that have been given, but the greatest gift and the greatest exchange was the gift that God gave us in His Son, Jesus Christ. Do you think it's really possible to have all of your guilt removed? Let's be honest. We've all got stuff in our past that we struggle with feeling guilty about. The kids you picked on in junior high, right? Stuff you said to mom and dad when you were a kid. Opportunities that you had and didn't seize, right? There's all these things. And so there is this sense of guilt. And even people like many of us that are devout Christians and we love Jesus, but there's still the issue of guilt. Do we fully understand that Jesus came to deliver us from guilt and to give us a clear conscience? Man, a clear conscience is worth a lot, isn't it? To lay your head on the pillow at night, to have peace with God and peace with other people. You know, the older I get, and Rick, you mentioned this once about how the older we get, it seems like the more valuable peace is. I don't know that as a younger man I thought a lot about peace, but the older I get, the more I think about just how good it is to have peace with my wife, peace with my kids, peace with my God, peace with myself, the peace of a clear conscience that only Jesus can truly give us. So I want us to take a look real quick here at three facts that I think can help us to understand how Jesus does in fact remove our guilt and allows us to have a clear conscience. Now, maybe today you've got a full handle on this. It's like, yep, I got this. Great, pray for me, okay? But for those of you that still struggle, and maybe you've never had a relationship with Jesus, but if you've never known Christ, hold on and listen, because I believe that God wants to speak to you. You know, I love the passion of the Apostle Paul. He uses a word we don't typically use very much. He says in verse 20, he says, "We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God." When was the last time you heard anybody in a regular conversation, "I implore you"? But what does that word mean? It means this comes from the depth of my heart. Would you please, I implore you, be reconciled to God through faith in Christ. And this is the Apostle Paul's passion. And on this Christmas Eve Sunday, I can tell you this is the passion of your pastor. You know, we've all got people in our lives, people that we work with, in our families, people that we live next to. We want to see everybody we know. Am I right? Everybody we know, we want them to know Jesus Christ. And so when Paul says, "I implore you," I want you to know out there on Facebook land and any person here today that doesn't know Christ, I implore you, there is a way home. There is a way to be forgiven of all your guilt and to have a clear conscience that will last you all through eternity. This is the great exchange. And so, first of all, the first fact is this: we are sinners. Now, if you're already struggling with guilt, I'm not helping you any. But let's be real. We are all sinners. Now, you know, that's another word that we don't use very often in normal conversation. "Hey, how's your week going, Tony?" "Well, been sinning a little bit, but not too bad." I mean, now, we might believe that, right? But, I mean, that is, you know, that's... We say, "Well, I've been wrestling with temptation," or, "I've not been as nice as I could have been." You know, I mean, right? But we don't just kind of like throw that word sin out there. Yeah, I've been having some sin issues this week. I mean, it's just not the way we talk. So, well, that's a churchy word, but what is a sin? A sin is a violation of God's truth and God's commands. When we don't do what God, our Creator, tells us to do, and to be honest, what our own conscience tells us is right. Are you with me? Right. We all know in our conscience right from wrong. We choose wrong and we're not willing to do the right. That is a sin. That is a place of infraction. That is a broken place. Now, there are a lot of people who would tell you that, you know, Pastor, I'm gonna take issue with this. I'm not really a sinner. I'm what? I'm a good person. I mean, let's be honest. When we've been to funerals and we've talked with people, pretty much universally, what do people say when they're standing there at the casket and they say, "Well, in a better place." I said, well, why would he be in a better place? Because he was a good guy. She was a good gal. And you know what? There is that, I'm just going to call it a religion in America. It's kind of a religion of goodness, right? We are all, how many of you, well, don't raise your hand. How many of you believe you're a good person? I mean, probably most of us would say, you know, I'm working on that. But bottom line, I know I've sinned and come short of the glory of God. But there is this attitude that we're a good person. You know, what does Santa ask? Have you been good? And of course, we're all going to quickly say, yes. And we want to get all our presents, don't we, Tony? Yeah. There is this universal goodism that is really the national religion, I believe, of America. But you know, the Bible is so clear in stating that all have sinned. We've all come short of the glory of God. We've all missed the mark. We've all not done it all right. You know, goodism would say, well, you know, I've tried hard. I've never killed anybody. And you know, sometimes it's been really tempting. You know, I'm, thank you, Emery. You know, they say, well, you know, I mow my lawn, I take out my trash, I'm good to my wife, I feed my dog, I work when I'm on the clock most of the time, and, you know, I never say anything bad about people, might think it, but I don't say it, you know, it's like, you know, I'm a pretty good guy. But the Bible makes it plain that all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You know, the question that always kind of gets me whenever I think about this whole thing of goodism, because there are some really good people out there, right? They do so many good things. But here's the question. Could you have done better? Well, yeah, I could have, but I was really tired. I was stressed. If I had done that, it would have run me short of cash. But the question, could you have done better? Could you have been a more good person? Could you have been a better person? And the answer, I think even the best person you've ever met would obviously say, well, no, I haven't been. And you know what? That's not good. We could have all done better. So when we look at 2 Corinthians 5:21, that God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, I'm reminded that I'm a guy who needs a Savior. I think I've told you the story before how when I was a kid, mom and dad turned me loose on a little rubber raft, and I was floating around, and we were at the beach at the ocean, and you know how the tide can like keep taking you further and further out, right? And so here I am, and mom and dad are getting farther away on the beach, and I'm out there going, and they're like, you know, and I'm like, you know, and they just, oh, smile and wave, and it's like, man, you know, I'm going to end up in Bermuda. It's like, this is not going good. I knew I needed to be saved. I was in trouble. And a surfer came along and grabbed a hold of me and tugged me into shore. Man, that guy was my hero because he could tell I was in distress. Even though mom and dad were oblivious, they thought I was having fun. I mean, I was probably like 25 feet from the beach. But when you're a little kid, everything's bigger, right? You know, and it was a scary moment. I knew I needed to be saved. And I'm here today saying I still need to be saved. I am so aware that even having pastored for 35 years and walked with Jesus for, tried to walk with him closely for the last 40 years, raised in church, I still have a sin problem. I still think things I shouldn't think. Sometimes I'll say things I shouldn't say. Sometimes I pass many opportunities to do good when I know I should have stopped. You know, at my core, I am selfish. I need a Savior. Which leads us then to the second truth, and that is that Jesus Christ is sinless. Jesus Christ is sinless. You know, sometimes we think, well, yeah, he was the Son of God. Of course he was sinless, but he was in all ways human, such as we are, and yet was without sin. Can you imagine going through your teenage years and never sinning? Can you imagine going through the terrible twos and not being terrible? I mean, when we talk about Jesus being sinless, we're not just talking about, oh, well, after he was baptized, then he, you know, he didn't commit any sins. No, he was sinless from the very beginning. He won every battle with temptation. He was victorious over every attempt of the enemy to drag him down. He was perfect. You know, I often think about how tough it would have been to be Jesus' brothers and sisters. You know, Jesus did have brothers and sisters, right? He was the firstborn, but how many times brothers and sisters get that? Why can't you be more like Jesus? I mean, that would be a tough act to follow, wouldn't it? To have an older brother who was perfect, who always did everything right. Well, that was the case with Jesus. Never cursed, never took advantage of anybody, never used his powers to benefit himself, but he was always doing, thinking, and saying the right things that honored his Father. And you know, when it came down to the end of Jesus' life, when the people that wanted to get rid of him, it's like, okay, we have got to come up with something. Do you remember what they did? You remember how Jesus finally got convicted? They got in a couple of false witnesses to speak against Jesus, and on the basis of two false witnesses, Jesus was condemned to death. So Jesus was sinless, and you and I are sinners. What took place in the great exchange solved man's problems. Because as we've read, and I want to read it again, God made him, Jesus, who had no sin, to be sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Can I just repeat again that you and I had no chance to save ourselves? Right? We could never be good enough. We could never do it all right. Even if you said today, I'm going to live my life perfectly, and if you were to be able to do that, you would still have a problem with all of the life before that. Right? You know, it's like when you go to your high school reunion, they tell you that, hey, what do you do for a living? You know, everybody wants to know what you do for a living. And when you tell them, well, I'm a pastor now, and they look at you, huh, never saw that coming. You know, that, that tells you, and that was my story, that tells you that you weren't the most upstanding young man or young woman when you were in high school and junior high. You know, and that's my story. I'm a sinner. I can't buy my way in. I can't good my way in because I have a past that I can never erase. All my righteousness, as the Bible says, is as filthy rags. And yet today, how many people hang their hat on the fact that they're a good person? And you hate to really argue with somebody and just point out and say, no, you're really not. I mean, that's kind of blunt, and that might kind of be a conversation ender. But the reality is, if we are honest, we've never met a good person truly good in our lives. Jesus is the only one. And that is why Jesus was willing to trade places. So here's the third flat fact. At the cross, we traded places. First of all, Jesus accepted our punishment. Say, well, why did Jesus have to take our punishment? Well, the Bible says something very interesting. It talks about how God is both just and the justifier. Now, what does that mean? If something were to happen where, let's say, I stole Anita's purse, and Anita's in trouble now for Christmas because she doesn't have any Christmas cash and it's all gone, and I stole that, and in heaven, you know, I stand before the judgment seat, and God's like, yeah, we're not going to worry about that, Darren. It's no big deal. How many of you think Anita might be a little bit upset? It's like, hey, this guy stole my purse. He ruined Christmas of 23 because he took what was mine, and I had all kinds of trouble. And God's like, no, we're just going to wipe that away. That would not be a very just judge, right? That just totally dismissed it and said, it's no big deal. But see, God is the just and the justifier because God made Jesus, who had no sin, no record, no list of offenses, God made him, Jesus, who had no sin, to become sin. So for my purse stealing, Jesus died. For my junior high and high school years, Jesus died. For every bad thought I've ever entertained, every bad word or action that I have ever pursued, Jesus paid the penalty. Jesus bore my stripes, and Jesus did the same thing for you. Now, you know, when we kind of go on back to this goodism thing, and we say, well, I've lived a good life. Yeah, but you really haven't. You deserve punishment. You deserve the consequence of your sin. And God tells us that Jesus took our place and he paid the penalty. Did you know that Rembrandt and Mel Gibson have something in common other than that their name starts with M? Actually, Rembrandt doesn't start with an M, does it? Okay, I'm a little off there. I had Michelangelo on my brain. But they do have something in common. Ride with me. Here it is this. Rembrandt was known for putting himself in his paintings. And he did a famous painting in 1633. And it was called The Raising of the Cross. And when Rembrandt painted that painting, he put himself in that painting at the foot of the cross, looking like Rembrandt, looking like a Renaissance man, and the spotlight is on him, and he is at the foot of the cross helping to raise the cross. You know why he did that? Because he understood that Jesus was being crucified for him. Now, what does he have to do with Mel Gibson? Well, Mel Gibson made that famous movie, The Passion of the Christ, right? And you remember the scene where maybe like I did, I close my eyes, but where the hand of Jesus is stretched out on the cross, and another hand comes and puts a nail in the palm of that hand, and the hammer gets ready to come down on that nail, and you just want to close your eyes. You don't want to see that. Do you know whose hand held the nail that was going into the hand of Jesus? It was Mel Gibson. He used his hand as an indicator, a reminder, a testimony that Jesus died for Mel Gibson's sin, that it was Mel Gibson who put Jesus on the cross. And in the same way, we can agree with Rembrandt that it was for our sins, certainly not for Jesus' sins, because he didn't have any. On the cross, he took our punishment. And that's why we get so passionate about Christmas. Yes, the manger scene is wonderful, and the miracles of the wise men, the shepherds, and all of that is a beautiful story. But the thing that pierces our hearts is the reality that Jesus didn't come here to be admired. He came to bear our sins. We read this in Isaiah. And John, you've got that passage for us there, Isaiah 53. This was like some 700 years before Jesus was born. And yet here it is. This is Isaiah writing about the suffering servant Jesus. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. But he, Jesus, was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities, and the punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. The only hope we have is Jesus Christ. He bore our sins on the cross. You know, it's very common today to hear people say, well, there's many ways to heaven, right? There's many ways. You know, every culture's got their different path, and all the paths end up in the same place, and it's all good. That is not what the Bible teaches. And I can't think of a more cruel father than God if there were many ways to heaven, but he let Jesus suffer the way he did, to be scourged, crucified, died, and yet there were other ways that would have got a person to heaven. Can you imagine that? Now, son, I'm going to have you die on the cross. Now, there are other ways that people can get there, but you're going to be one of the ways. Jesus is the way and the truth and the life. No man comes to the Father except through him. There are not many ways to heaven. And if you say, well, Christianity is just one way, well, Jesus said he's the only way. And so we have a problem there, don't we? Jesus was lying. Jesus was deceiving. Doesn't sound like Savior material. But when Jesus tells us that no man comes to the Father except through him, he meant it. Jesus took our punishment. But the best is yet to be here. My best Billy Mays voice, let me tell you, the best is yet to be. Not only did Jesus take our punishment, but Jesus credited us with his righteousness. You know, it's one thing to be forgiven. It is another thing to be credited with perfection. And we've been talking about this a lot here in 23, about our identity in Christ, right? We've been talking about how God sees us versus how we feel about ourselves, how he looks at us and sees in us the perfection of his Son. And that's why he can do it. Because Jesus paid the penalty of our sins. And in the place of penalty, God gave us reward. God credited us with the perfection of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, it is a gift to be redeemed, to be bought back. We were lost, the Bible says, without God and without hope in this world. And yet Jesus came and died so that we can live. And you know, it's real easy to let this be mind-numbing. Some of you may have grown up in a church where every Sunday a salvation message was preached, and that's good, but sometimes we can get a little dull. We can get a little dull to the fact that Jesus died to give us eternal life. Yeah, that's good, Pastor, but tell us some funny stories. You know, give us some chuckles. Tell us some stuff. It's like, no, this is Christianity. This is the message of Christmas, that Jesus came to this earth to lay his life down, to bear the punishment that you and I deserved so that we could have the gift of eternal life, and not just to live forever, not just to be sinners that have been saved by grace, but to be people that are credited with Jesus' perfection. That is where we have no guilt, and that's where we have a clear conscience. Jesus died for us to have the gift of a clear conscience between us and God. Sorry about my microphone. I'm not going to try to switch batteries on it now. Just hang with me. I'm just about done. I heard somebody say amen out there. The great exchange. God loves you so much that he sent Jesus to live a sinless life, to go to the cross, to die in your place and credit you with his perfection so that you could become a part of God's forever family. Now, church, that is a gift. I don't know what all you're going to get for Christmas, but you're not going to get anything like what God's already given us, the gift of his son. You know, this is Christmas, understanding that there was an exchange that was made. That video was perfect. You know, we come to Jesus, and you caught that was Jesus, right? The blood on his hand. We come to Jesus with a box of our junk, broken hearts, broken relationships, every part of us a mess. We come to Jesus with a box of mess. And Jesus takes our mess and gives us a miracle. He changes us because we can't change ourselves. You know, we got self-help stuff out the wazoo, don't we? To try to be to become something that we're not. And I'm going to grab Tara's mic here, so I want you to hear. We don't need more help for self-help because it's impossible, isn't it? We can't help ourselves. But the message of Christmas is that God stepped in and helped us when we could not help ourselves. Jesus died so that we could live. You know, this brings us back to the message of Christmas. How do you get a gift? Somebody hands it to you, and what do? You have to take it. And today, on this Christmas Eve Sunday, Jesus is offering you the gift of himself. He wants you in his forever family. He wants you to know him. You know, Jesus died out of love. You know, people say, well, he was nailed to the cross. Nails didn't keep him on the cross, right? It wasn't nails that kept him up there. He could have, the scripture says he could have called 12 legions of angels to come and rescue him, but he wouldn't do it because he was dying so that you and I could live. He laid his life down so we could get ours back. That's what kept him on the cross. And finally, at the end, he said, "It is finished." And in Greek, it is one word, tetelestai, and it was a business word, and it means paid in full. Can we just lift our hands and say, "Jesus, thank you. It's paid in full, not paid in part. It's not something that was done just a little bit. It was done completely. Every sin debt that you and I have has been paid in full by the Lord Jesus Christ, and we have been given the gift of life." So there is a gift being extended to you today. It is the gift of Jesus himself. But I do want to tell you that this is a limited time offer. It's a limited time offer. Because the Bible also tells us that there is a day coming, and I believe it's soon, that Jesus is going to come back for his church. And he's going to come back for the people who love Jesus Christ. Are you in that number? I'm not asking you if you know about Jesus, not asking you if you've ever read the Bible, not asking if you've ever said a prayer. I'm asking you, have you been a participant in the great exchange? The take-home there, John. Have you personally participated in the great exchange? Have you accepted Jesus' gift of eternal life? Have you asked Jesus to forgive you? And have you received his gift of a clear conscience and a clean heart? You know, we always think we've got more time. Well, this is good food for thought, Pastor. I'm going to think about this. But you know, there's people that had plans for this Christmas that didn't make it. And now they're standing before God, wishing they had been a part of the great exchange. You know, it's not just hearing about the gospel. It's personally receiving Jesus, asking him into your heart to forgive you of your sins, to give you the gift of eternal life. There is a moment of time when we are born again. A moment of time when we renounce our old life and we say, "Jesus, I'm yours. Come into my life. Change me. I need a complete extreme makeover. Jesus, turn me inside out and make me who you want me to be." But you know, that's not such a bad thing, really, when you think that Jesus loved me so much that he would die for me, that if that same Jesus has a plan for my life, how many of you think that would probably be a good plan? And you know what happens? It happened to me when I was a young man. I gave my life to Jesus when I was 10. I got baptized and I got a BB gun when I was 10. Both of them very important to me. But I got into my teenage years and Jesus meant less and less. And I quit going to church and I made sure I worked on Sundays so I didn't have to go. And, you know, I went in the Navy because I was kind of wanting to do my own thing. And I had to come to a place where I recommitted my life to Christ and went back to that and said, "Jesus, you know, I've made a mess of my life. I have not honored you with my life. Jesus, forgive me. And I want to recommit my life to you." And how many of you say, honestly, you've had to recommit your life at some time? Just raise a hand. See, this is a normal thing. This happens. It happens all the time. And that's good. We need to be constantly in a broken state before God. "Jesus, I want to live for you. You died for me. How can I live for myself anymore?" The great exchange. I'm a sinner. Jesus is sinless. And on the cross, we traded places. I hope you hear that today. You out there in Facebook, I hope you hear that today. There is no other way to make peace with God than through faith in Jesus Christ. I'm going to just boldly tell you that all of the major religions that are out there, they miss it. They miss Jesus. He is the Savior of the world. Call upon the name of the Lord, the Bible says, and you will be saved. I'm going to ask you all to stand with me. I know we've got things on our agenda that we want to do next, and probably it's easy to think about that, but can I just ask you, have you personally participated in the great exchange? Have you asked Jesus to forgive your sins and to come into your heart? Amen. Mary Lou's had a miracle. Yes. Amen. 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 In her eyes. Praise God. So there's a testimony of somebody who's walked with Jesus. What about you? Do you know him? If you're not a Christian today, out there in Facebook land, right here in the house, today, if you would like to lift your hand, I would be glad to pray with you. I'm not going to embarrass you. We're not going to call you up front. We're just going to pray a simple prayer where you ask Jesus to come into your heart and to be your Lord and Savior. Jesus died so that you could live. The gift is ready. The choice is yours. Is there anybody right now, as I pray, just lift a hand. Jesus, you see the hearts. If there's anybody in the house today that needs to lift their hand, Jesus, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for that young man in the back there. Hallelujah. Anybody else? Say, you know, I need to commit my life to Jesus or recommit my life to Jesus. Is there anybody else in the house out there in Facebook land? You know that you need Jesus in your life. You need to come back to him if you've gotten away or you've never been a Christian and today you want to start. Is there anybody? Just lift a hand. We'll be glad to pray. All right. Hey, brother back there, I appreciate you. I know we've met before. I don't remember your name, but I want you to know this. Jesus loves you. He saw that hand. And I want you to pray this prayer out loud with me, and I want all the folks here at Eagle Mountain to pray this same prayer. And the Bible says that that your commitment and willingness to receive Christ is going to change you. And anybody out there in Facebook land, if you need Christ, pray this prayer with me. Church, can we pray this together? Dear Jesus, I am a sinner. I've broken your rules. But I believe you died for me. You paid my penalty. And now, Jesus, I give you my life. Forgive me of all my sins. And be my Lord and Savior. Amen. Brother, thank you for that hand. And anybody else out there in Facebook that you prayed that prayer, you know, it changes things. It may seem like, well, that was just a little prayer, but it changes things. Jesus changes lives. There's hope. Jesus can fix any broken thing. Any broken thing, he can fix it. He's a miracle worker. Amen. If you need a miracle, I just want to pray for you before I turn it over to Tara. If you need a miracle, would you just lift a hand right now and let me pray? Just, you need a miracle, literally, okay? Many hands all over the house. Jesus, right now, there is a need for your grace and power and touch in the lives of your people. Jesus, in this house, I believe there's an anointing right now to just believe and to seek your face for a miracle, God, to bring a healing, to bring a restoration, to bring provision, to give wisdom, to show guidance. Jesus, we look to you. And God, for every hand extended, Jesus, we pray for mercy, for grace, and miracle power to be released in the lives of your people. God, thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for a Christmas miracle, God, as we look to you. Father God, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Terry and the team are going to lead us in a closing chorus.
Imagine being there right in the throne room with God and worshiping and bowing before Him.
Sing Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. The Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Holy, holy, are you, Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
God, I just give you thanks and praise. And Lord, I pray now that as we go about our day, that we will keep you as the center of our focus, that we will focus in on you and not let the things of this earth or the things of this world let us stray from that. But Lord, we will have peace in everything that we do today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Merry Christmas.
To the world the Lord is come.